Hey, good morning, Purpose Church. Welcome to Church Online. My name's Alicia Brown, AB, and I'm so excited to be the first to welcome you to Church Online today. We've got a great service plan like we do every single week. And if it's your first time joining us, we just want to say welcome to Purpose Church. Welcome to the Purpose family. We say it all the time around here that we're not like family, we are family. And we would just love if we could welcome you into our family this morning. So if you could, if it's your first time, pull out your phone and text the word new to the number you see on the screen below. 270-229-6488. We're not going to show up at your house. We're not going to send you cookies. We're not going to call you a whole bunch of times. We just want to do this thing called life alongside you and welcome you into our family. So if you could, like I said, pull out your phone and text the word new to the number you see on the screen. You picked a great Sunday to join us. We're continuing in our series, Asking for a Friend. And throughout this series, we're just taking some of the big questions that you submitted and finding godly answers to them, right? We all have questions about things that go on in life, and we want to know what the Bible says about them, and that's what we're doing in the series. So today, we're continuing that. Pastor Dustin's going to be talking to us, how do I handle stress? Life's full of stress. I'm stressed. You're stressed. I'm sure you feel stress at times. But Pastor Dustin today is going to be walking us through how do we handle stress? How do we deal with that? You know, what do we do? What's the Bible say about handling that? So you picked a great Sunday to join us. It's going to be great. Next week, I know you're joining us online today, but next week you'll be sure to join us in person because next week we're going to actually be doing baptism. Now, we did it a few weeks ago, but we've had lots of people, you know, make that public profession of faith. And so it's time for baptism again. And so if you or someone you know is interested in being baptized, text the word baptism to the number you see on the screen, 270-229-6488. And it'll get you signed up. And we've got a cool shirt that says Made New on it, which talks about how you're made new in Christ, which is what baptism is a symbol of, you know, the old life being buried, new life being raised. And so that'll be next week in person at Coway County Middle School, both for the 9 and the 10:30 service. So if you're interested in joining us, please do. We'd love to have you. Well, hey, we do something every week around here. It's called Minute Mingle. And the purpose of this isn't, you know, just to fill the comments up. It's so that we can get to know each other. You know, we say we're not like family, we are family. And you know things about your family. So we want to know about you. What's a movie that's made you cry? Drop it in the comments below. Now, it doesn't have to be like giant waterworks. Maybe even tear up a little if you're not a big crier. But what's a movie that's made you cry? Drop it in the comments below. Let us know. I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to get started worshiping this morning. Dear God, thank you for the chance to come and gather together, God, even through screens, even online, and be able to worship you this morning, God. Thank you for the team that makes this happen every single week. God, thank you for their efforts. God, I pray that you bless them. God, bless Pastor Dustin as he brings us this message. Bless our worship team as they lead us. And bless my friends as they listen this morning. God, speak to them where they're at. God, speak into their stress this morning. God, help them to be able to give that up to you by the end of this morning. We pray. Amen. All right, let's worship together.
Power, rise to my lips too. Church, come on, why don't we put our hands together and celebrate Jesus? It's October. Come on, somebody. We made it. We're in October. I'm so thankful for you. I'm so glad that you're here. Thank you for being at church today. And I'll just tell you, I'm so excited about today. First of all, let me just honor Kyle Williams this last week, bringing that word on spiritual warfare. So practical for you and I as we go throughout our everyday lives, how we can put on that armor of faith, how we can go out and we can battle. So thank you, Kyle. Why don't we, in the comment section below, just give Kyle some praise hands, just some high fives, tag him in this, tell him how much we appreciate that word. And so thank you so much, Kyle, for doing that last week, kicking off this series, because I know this series is going to be important for a lot of us, because guess what? We all have questions, and right, this series, Asking for a Friend, is this idea that we have questions about the Bible, we got questions about life, how do we do this thing, and we just want to do a good job of answering those questions, right? I don't know about you, I've got just some regular questions. Like, I don't know about this, like, somebody needs to answer this question. I don't know what we're going to get to today, but like, questions like, listen, why is it called a building if it's already been built? You know what I'm saying? Like, that's a question that I would like to know. Why is it that we park in a driveway and we drive on a parkway? Come on, somebody. That's a good question to ask. I don't know. I don't know why that's the case. What about this one? Why is there no egg in eggplant? Not really sure. No egg there. But what's the answer to that? I don't really know. The last one, my favorite one that I just want to ask you and just get your opinion on. Once you put your comments in the comment section below, do penguins have knees? Come on, somebody. That's a question I want to know. Type in the comment section, yes, penguins have knees, or no, they don't. Keep the comments civil. We're not going to get in a big argument over penguins' knees, okay? But here's the idea, is that we get this idea of you asking the questions about the Bible, because it comes from really this idea that it all begins with kind of how Jesus did in his life, in his ministry. What happened is that oftentimes the very sermon topics that we see throughout the Bible, that Jesus, his actual sermons came from questions that the crowd asked, right? So he's answering everyday practical questions, and they asked the questions, and Jesus would turn around and he would turn it into a beautiful message. So that's what we want to do throughout this whole series, Asking for a Friend. You've asked the questions. Now we want to do a good job of pointing to the godly answers to the questions that you have asked. And I don't know about you, but today we're going to answer this question of how in the world do I handle stress? Come on, somebody. I don't know about you, but I have a very stressful life. We all do. I think obviously we live in a world right now that is full of stress, and so many people have questions about how do I handle that? Like, how do I balance life and time? And I'm stressed out with the kids and jobs and recreational activities and sports and busy weekends. And then you throw all of the other pressures of life on top of those things, and we can become pretty stressed, right? So how do I handle being stressed? I did a little research this week and found out, in fact, that literally 44% of Americans say that they have more stress than they did 5 years ago. So what that is telling me is that literally your stress level and my stress level on average is growing 10% a year. That's a whole lot, right? Like, think about it. In 10 years, that would be your stress level now is doubled to 100% more. That's kind of the norm of what's happening right now in culture. They tell us that one in every five people would fall underneath this category of extreme stress. What does extreme stress mean? Meaning that you actually have a physical side effect due to stress that's in your life. Maybe you got a little shaking going on right now because you're thinking about like all the stuff that you got to go on in your life and you're stressed about it. Your heart's beating a little too fast. Your blood pressure may be a little higher. Like you're not sleeping well. Maybe you're struggling with depression. One out of every five. And I think that number is climbing. And that's a pretty big epidemic that we're in, if you asked me, right? They tell us also that 60% of all illnesses and diseases actually have their root in stress levels. That's crazy to me. That's unbelievable to me. So that's sometimes playing a role in the fact that you and I get sick or we're going through certain things. So I just obviously believe you've asked this question. I believe it's a really relevant topic that we want to be very relevant. We want to be very real. And we want to help answer this idea of how in the world do I handle the stress of life? How do I do that? And so I just thought I would throw up on the screen right now. Not throw up, but like put up on the screen right now, some things that you and I stress out about, right? Like one, we stress out about relationships, okay? We stress out. There's something about relationships that raise the level of stress in our life. Conflict, right? Conflict even in relationships that happen. Okay, there's some stress levels that happen there. Marriage, right? Maybe some of you are saying, I'm sitting next to my stress level. Just keep your eyes ahead, okay? Just keep looking straight ahead at the screen, all right? Maybe that's something that adds to your stress, or maybe it's the fact that you're not married that stresses you out. You know what I'm saying? Maybe it's deadlines, right? You've got deadlines at work, or you got deadlines in life, or whatever else. You've got the rent that's due. You got all this kind of stuff. Maybe it's the legal problems that you're facing. Maybe it's the fact that you're going through a divorce, or you're still dealing with the ramifications of divorce. Maybe you've got a new job, right? Maybe it's the new job that's stressing you out. Maybe it's the old job that's stressing you out. Come on, somebody, right? Is this something about stress? Maybe it's an illness that you're going through. Right now, a stressor for Allie and I is parenting, right? We've welcomed two more baby girls into this world, and parenting becomes a stress. It's something that happens. Maybe it's you're trying to live up to the expectations of other people. That puts some stress on you, right? Maybe it's unresolved sin. Maybe it's something that you've been hiding in the shame and the guilt of that, and you're in your sin and you haven't resolved that yet. Boy, that will wear you out, right? And can I tell you something really quick? Let me just stop right there. I want to challenge you. Don't leave here today with unresolved sin. Don't stop watching today without settling that sin with God, asking for forgiveness, and then also confessing it to somebody else. James 5:16 tells us that we ask God for forgiveness, but it's healing that comes in a form of confessing our sins to each other, right? So I encourage you, that unresolved sin, man, get that handled and in check. And the last thing I think is just stressful, a huge source of stress will be Louisville fans. Come on, somebody, right? All right, I just throw a little something light in there at the end. If you don't know, I'm a big UK fan. I graduated from the University of Kentucky, and so I'm grateful to be a Wildcat. That was just a little something fun at the end, okay? But this is the idea I want you to understand. The truth is we all have all kinds of stress and sources of stress in our lives. And the Bible talks about a lot of this. The Bible can declare some things to you and I that I think we got to learn and we got to look at. In fact, I want you to understand that Jesus promised that it was going to be this way, right? I think there's a common misnomer out there with Christianity that if you give your life to Jesus, everything's going to be perfect, right? It's just going to all work out. It's just going to be just fantastic all the time, like puking rainbows and unicorns, right? Like that's just what's happening. I just made two throw-up references in my sermon. I ain't even been 10 minutes in yet. I don't know. Maybe it's just the baby spit up that's in my head all the time, okay? I don't know what it is. But this is the idea that Jesus even promised that there was going to be things that happen in this life. Like he promised you that everything might go wrong. This is what he said in John 16:33. He said, hey, I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. And he goes on to say, hey, in this world, guess what? You're going to have some trouble. Okay, you're going to have trouble. You're going to have stressors. You're going to have things that are overwhelming to you. It's going to happen. But God's solution isn't to just take the trouble out of your life and my life. It's that in the very middle of that trouble that you can do what he says next. Take heart, because I've overcome the world. And that's what I want to help show you today. That's what I want to help just get inside of your spirit today, that I can't guarantee you that your circumstances will change, but what I can guarantee you is that there is peace available in the middle of your circumstances. And I believe that for you. Another verse, and I love this verse. It's in Psalms, and this is what it says. Psalm 34, the righteous person faces many troubles. Right? It's going to happen. Even the godly people, even people that know the Lord, listen, it's going to happen. You're going to have some trouble in your life, but look what the Bible says. But the Lord comes to the rescue each and every time. I love that right there. So for those of you who said, God, you know, like, what in the world is going on? Like, I'm praying. I'm a good person. I went to church every Sunday this last month, right? It doesn't necessarily work that way, okay? He doesn't reward that by taking away your trouble. No. The purpose of all of those things, like reading your Bible, praying, giving, serving, coming to church, being a part of those things, are to facilitate the ability inside of you to be able to walk through those things and not necessarily be delivered from them, but be able to walk through them with some peace. This is what I know. The closer that you and I, we get to God, the more you're in love with Jesus, the more you're in love with the Lord. He doesn't take the thing away. He just gives you the capacity to handle it in the very middle of the thing that you're walking through. And I believe that for all of us. And that's what I want to help us with today. And that word right there in Psalms is the word troubles, is actually the Hebrew word, which that's what the Old Testament was written in Hebrew, and it was actually an Assyrian form of torture. So that same word that says troubles right there, it was an Assyrian form of torture where they would literally stand you up on a post, they'd strap you to it, and then rock by rock, they would pile these big rocks around you and on you until it crushed you to death. That's the word. That's a tough word, right? And for some of you, you came to church today watching online, and that's exactly how you feel. That literally life is putting rocks, and if one more rock gets on top of you, that you're going to be crushed. But I came to tell you today that there's hope in the midst of what you're going through, that you can handle the stress, that God can give you the ability to walk through what you're going through if we'll do it God's way. I just believe that for you. And so again, I want to kind of just point us to Scripture today, and there's this one Scripture that really just kind of arrested me, just kind of just held on to me a little bit when I was looking up, hey, how do we handle stress? How can we find some peace in the middle of all of that? And Psalm chapter 62 really spoke to me, and I want to just pass it on to you. And I think there's some good things that we can learn from this passage of Scripture. This is what it says, starting in verse number 5. It says this, find rest, O my soul. Right? Come on, somebody. Who needs some rest, right? We live in a stressful world. Find rest, O my soul. In what? In God alone is what it says. In God alone, my hope comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. That's what it says. Trust in Him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. And at the very end of that, there is this word that is used 77 times in the book of Psalms, and it's this word Selah. Somebody just type that in there, Selah, S-E-L-A-H. Type that in the comment section, Selah. And just say it out loud. That's a fun word to say, Selah. I like that. And that word right there literally is a Hebrew musical term. And I want to just kind of like, what would happen is these psalms right here that we read would actually be sung. So you got the spirit keys playing. They'd be singing this song. The band would finish up. And next thing you know, this word Selah comes up. And it's basically meaning for you and I that you need to think on these things. You need to pause. We need to reflect a little bit on what was just said or what was just sung. And I love that that's there, because this is what I know about Purpose Church. And I love the fact that you're at church today. And I love that this place offers every single week that refuge that God offers us as well. I love that all the confusion. Sometimes people come up to me and say, man, the only place I find peace is when I'm locked into Purpose Church, when I come to church. And I think that's great. I love all the confusion and the pain and the problems and just the things that this world offers you and I that are bombarding our minds, that you can come in and you can kind of just pause and redirect your thoughts and just reflect a little bit. I'm glad it's happening at Purpose Church, but you need to know that you can also have that peace anywhere that you go throughout the week. That you have the ability to do that. And I think this scripture kind of points to a few things that we can find rest in, that we can find that refuge in God, even if we're not at church, even if we're not in the building. I think it's important, but I also think that you can find that peace wherever you go. This is what it says in verse 9, and I jumped over to the NLT version, which is just a different translation. I like it how it said this, and this is what it said. Common people are as worthless as a puff of wind, and the powerful are not what they appear to be. So the people who you and I think are happy because they got all this earthly success and all these things out there, guess what? They're probably not as happy as you think that they are. They're actually probably a little bit more miserable than you think. And it goes on to say, if you weigh them on the scales, right? If you really just looked at their life together, they're lighter than a breath of air. So we see those two lines right there. Both of them have the same condition, is that their life and their time is short, right? We see that they're just nothing but a puff of air or a breath of air. The book of James in the Newer Testament also says that our life is like a vapor, right? That it's here today, it's gone tomorrow. And then notice that the author not only talks about that topic, but goes on to another topic in the next verse. And it says, don't make your living by extortion and put your hope in stealing. And if your wealth increases, guess what? Don't make it the center of your life. So what's the author trying to say to us? The author is trying to tell you and I, hey, don't fall in love with that stuff. Don't think that that stuff is going to make you happy, that that's going to allow your stress levels to go down. Because this is what I know, and I want to talk to you about these two things today, that I believe these are the two main culprits of stress in our life. I believe it. I think I can look at my own life and say, yep, I can acknowledge that. Yep, these two things really do are the culprits that we even see right here in Psalm chapter 62. And so he brought that whole idea up. The very first one I want to tell you about is this idea of time, right? So he brought up this idea that your life is being weighed, and that your life is literally just like a breath where it's here and then it's gone. And that somehow, some way, I just believe that we're going to have to get a grasp on how we spend our time. Like, let me say it as plain as I can. And this is the pastor hat I'm putting on you right now. This is the pastor hat I'm talking to myself right now. And it's this idea that you can't do everything that you're currently doing. You can't do everything that you're currently doing. It's literally going to be impossible. And until we come to a place where we say, man, I got to figure out what my life's really all about. I'm going to focus my time and my energies and on those things. I got to stop trying to do everything that everybody asks me to do all the time. Because if we don't, guess what? We're going to burn out. We're going to give up. We're going to pull back. And when I read those verses in Psalm chapter 62, it just reminds me of another Old Testament story in Daniel, in the book of Daniel. I love the book of Daniel. We actually did a series on it, not this past summer, but the first summer as a church that we had together. And there's this story. Y'all remember that story of this guy's life? It's completely out of control. And next thing you know, we don't know if, like, it's about the handwriting on the wall. Y'all remember that? That's where we actually get that little quote from in real life. It comes from the book of Daniel, chapter 5. And so this guy's life is out of control, and now we don't know, like, if the hand just floating by itself, or it, like, comes out of the box like the Addams Family. Not really sure how that worked out exactly. We don't know what it is, but you know what happens is this hand appears, and it starts writing on the wall. And this is what it says in Daniel chapter 5. This is the inscription that was written. Many, many Tekel Parson. Right? And here's what those words mean. See, because in that time, nobody had any idea what was being shared, but there was this guy named Daniel, and he could interpret what was being written. And Daniel comes along and says, hey, this is what those words mean. Many, God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. Your days are numbered. You need to understand that. You need to know that. Tekel, you have been weighed on the scales. right? That can you see Psalm 50 or 62 right there? In that you've been weighed on the scales and found wanting. So we weighed your life. We took the balance of your life, and it just doesn't add up. It's not there. It's out of balance completely. And then the last one, Parson, your kingdom is divided. Your kingdom is divided. In other words, what he's saying to you and I is that your days are numbered. A lot of times your lives are out of balance. And if you and I don't do something about that, guess what it's going to do? It's going to cost us something. It's going to cost us something. And that's what the prophecy means. And I would just say that to you as well, that today, like, guess what? Your days are numbered. Welcome to Purpose Church. We're glad you're here, right? Like, this idea, I know it's not fun to hear, but our days are numbered on this earth. You only have a few of them left. And we all look, if we will look at our lives, and we'd ask the people around us, some people would speak into us and just say, hey, yo, your life is out of order. It's not in the right place. And if you don't do something, guess what it's going to do? It's going to cost you something. And I believe that's why you're watching today. I believe that there was just a prophetic word that needed to be spoken to you from God, that you need to make some adjustments in your life, that you need to make some course adjustments. And so here's the takeaway with one of those main culprits of stress in our life. Time. Guess what we need to do? We need to take inventory of our schedule. We need to look at our schedule, look at our life, look how you're trying to, all the things that you're trying to put in your life, and ask yourself and ask myself, is this right? Is this godly? Is this honoring? Is it out of balance or is it in balance? And now, something that Allie and I have to do, and especially now that we have four kids, holy moly, I just said we got four kids. That's crazy to me. But this idea that we have to sit down and we really have to talk about our schedules every single week is something that we tried to implement before our new baby girls came along, where we would just sit down, and we've got this thing called the marriage journal, and we'll look at each other's calendar. That's one of the questions that it has us ask back and forth. And we got to put our priorities in there: time with God, time with each other, time around the table as a family. And then we ask, can we fit anything else in this schedule? And if not, we have to make some decisions. We got to make some tough calls. And one of the best thing that you could do today on a Sabbath Sunday, right, where you're Sabbathing, is not just to go to church, but then take what is spoken to you at church and say, you know what, let's go home. Let's look at our life. Let's see how we can apply that to what was spoken to us at church. Let's do a little bit of adjusting today, because guess what, y'all? We all have a little adjusting to do as we go. And I just want to encourage you and challenge you. Where is your time going? I want to challenge you. Is it in the right place? Is it in balance? If it's not, let's make some course adjustments. I think that's going to help us with some stress today. The next thing that I think that Psalm 62 actually addresses, the second culprit, and it talks about it, is this idea of money. This idea of money. Now listen, we all know if there's ever going to be a source of stress in our life, come on somebody, it's around this idea of money, right? I don't know about you. It's the number one. These two things are the number one thing that Allie and I will argue about, that we'll fight with each other, is over time and it's over money. It's over schedules that I didn't communicate clearly, and it's over finances. And I always say it like this. Everybody gets funny when you start talking about money, right? Come on, right? It's just one of those things, and it's a great thing for all of us just to regularly look at our money. How are we spending it? Where is it going? How are we taking care of it? Like, are we buying all kinds of things that really we shouldn't be buying? And I remember the day that Allie and I had just like a come to Jesus meeting. You know what I'm talking about? Like just one of those come to Jesus meetings in marriage, right? Like why not let that meeting be today? And it was about, we were about 4 years into marriage, and we just looked at each other and we said, hey, we're living from like this check to this check. And yo, we can't be doing that anymore. We got debt. Let's get out of debt. Let's make it a goal of ours to get out of debt. And maybe it's not going to happen for you all at once. It's not happened all for us at once. It is a progress. It's something that we said, you know what? We're going to do the Dave Ramsey. We're going to pay off the smallest debt first. Then we're going to lump on that, what we were paying on that small debt. Let's get that next one and let's keep doing that. And you just take bites of it at a time. But we're working every day to make sure that we're living that out. Maybe for you, jump in that Financial Peace Crew, right? It's going to be launching off in January. I want you to do that. Jump in that Financial Peace Crew. Make some adjustments in your life, especially financially. The Bible tells us in 1 Timothy, it says, hey, you know what? Money's fine, but being in love with the money, that'll really mess you up. And look at what he says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 6. It says, but godliness with contentment is great gain. And we all need to just look at our lives. You and I, we got to look at it and make sure I'm not letting greed in my life. Make sure I'm not just wanting and getting all the signals from culture and society saying, you need to buy that, you need to get that. Make sure that I'm not going to fall into that trap. I want to be content. I want godliness with contentment. I want that to be a great gain. And this is what it says, for we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it. Old preachers used to say back in the day, you don't ever see no U-Haul behind a hearse. Come on, somebody, right? Can't take it with us, right? It's not something that we could do. But if we have food and clothing, guess what we're going to do? We're going to be content with that. So what are we going to do? We're going to try and simplify our life as best as we can. Those, it goes on to say, who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. That's pretty strong language right there, right? Pretty strong statement. And he goes on to say, for the love of money, not money itself, not that, no, but the love of it, or the bad understanding of what money is there for, is a root of all kinds of evil. And I would just say it's the root of all kinds of stress in our life. And I think, again, the number one thing that fights in families over money, the number one reason for divorce in America is money. And I just encourage you, it goes on to say, some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and have pierced themselves with many griefs. So what I want to encourage you to do today is just ask those questions. Hey, you know what? Whatever it takes, I'm going to put my life back in balance when it comes to time and when it comes to money. And this is where I would love, I was going to give you just some practical, real practical tips, like live off 10, 10, 80, do some things like that. But I felt in my spirit kind of a different direction, because that could literally, there's a lot of practical tips that I can give you that in your context may not work for you. But I really want to give you some principles to where you can make that decision for yourself of how you can really lay out your time, how you can really make that your finances are balanced together. And I think it goes back to this idea that how do I handle stress? It's this idea that you and I, we have to find rest, right? We got to find rest in my soul, like it said right there in Psalm chapter 62. Like, how in the world do I get rested in my soul? And I found a verse that I want to show you how to do that. And it's in Jeremiah chapter 6. And this is what the Bible says. This is what the Lord says. So I want you to hear it like that. It's not what Purpose Church says. It's not what Dustin says. Like, this is the Lord, what he's saying to you. Stand at a crossroads and look. In other words, there's an intersection that's going on. There is a point where there is a cross section that's happening. And we just did that we all have some fixing to do in our time and our money. We're at a crossroads. We've created that. So in other words, you and I, we can't keep going down that road that you're going on without making a decision. Stand at that crossroad and ask for the ancient paths. That's what it says. In other words, hey, go back to the good old-fashioned biblical God principles, because this is what I know. God's way works, right? It just works. And that's why you're here today, because you believe that. And I believe that for you. And ask where the good way is and walk in it. If you'll do it God's way, guess what you'll do? This is what it says right here. Watch. You will find rest for your souls. I'm hoping that would happen for you today. And so here's the deal. Instead of telling you exactly what to do with your time and your money, and honestly, for every one of us, it's a little bit different, I want to give you some principles that will help you figure it out yourself. And the very first thing I want to tell you, and we're going to speed through these three, is this idea that you and I, we got to live with a sense of purpose and urgency. Right? We got to live with a sense of purpose and urgency. Let me say it this way. One of the best ways for you to know what to do is to define what your life is all about. Right? Because here's what I know. When I know what my life is all about, it makes it easy for me to say yes to certain things and no to certain things. Because now I'm making decisions, those time and money decisions, based on, does this contribute to my purpose of what God has called me to do or not? Because listen, I've only got a few years left, right? My time is limited. I want to make sure, honestly, my life is nothing but a breath. It's real short. I only have a little bit of time to finish what God has called me to do. I want to be a man on purpose. I want you to be people on purpose. So why not just live my life as intentionally as I can towards that purpose, right? That's what we want to be about. And you honestly can't do that until you know why you're here. That's why I believe one of the greatest things about Purpose Church, it brings a pathway to you of discovering why you're here on this earth, of what God has created you to do. And listen, we have core values that we talk about all the time, that when you squeeze an orange, orange juice comes out. These are the things that we want to be known for. But here's what I want you to understand about the core values. They happen, and what happens with that is you can discover the fact is that you can discover those core values. The strategy that we use to get those core values inside of you and I to encourage us to be about that is through a kind of a strategy that we call Know God, Find Freedom, Discover Purpose, and Make a Difference. We want you to know God. That's what we're doing here. We're trying to encourage you in God. We're trying to tell you that a relationship with Jesus is the best decision that you'll ever make in your life. We want you to know God. And once you know God, guess what? There's some things in your life and my life that we got to get set free from, right? How many of y'all know some people that are saved, but they're just not set free? Come on, somebody, right? We think finding freedom happens in a context of a circle rather than in a row, like on Sunday morning. And we think that happens in a small group context. We call them crews, right? You're going to find some freedom when you get with some other people and you're able to just be real, to take the mask off literally and physically, right? Like you can literally take the mask off and you can just say, hey, here's what we're going through. Here's what we're struggling with. Here's what's happening in my life. So we want you to know God, find freedom. The next thing that we want you to do is discover your purpose. And this is what we do. We do this thing called Next. We want you to discover your purpose, right? It's designed for you to know why you're here on this earth. The Google tells us that the number one most Googled question in all of the universe is, what on earth am I here for? Like, why am I here? And we want to help as a team just discover what you're here to do. Like, again, if you can discover why you're on this planet, and listen to me, church, you can't make decisions about your time and money if you don't know why you're here on this earth. And I just encourage you, as soon as you do, though, oh my goodness, we're cooking, right? We're ready to go. And the wisdom of life, what happens is it consists of eliminating the non-essential things, right? I'm so sorry, I can't do that because it doesn't contribute to my purpose. I'm so sorry, I'm not going to spend money on that because it's not contributing to what God has called me to do in my life. And a lot of times, Allie and I, we say no to certain things that happen on Saturday nights because we know whatever we do on Saturday night, honestly, it affects how we are on Sunday mornings. And some people say, well, that's a sacrifice. No, it's the greatest privilege of my life to be able to be your pastor and to encourage you and do that. And so, again, we're able to say no because we know what our calling is. And I just encourage you, you got to discover that calling. You got to discover that purpose. And it happens on the first and third Sunday of the month. That's what I want to encourage you. Let me just encourage you real quick. You want to get signed up for Next? Text the word Next to the number 270-229-6488. Just text that. You'll get a message back. Text the word Next to 270-229-6488. That will let you know when we have Next again, and it'll get you signed up for that. I encourage you, go through that, do that, discover your purpose. And then once you discover your purpose, yours and my job is to go out and make a difference wherever God calls us to go. And again, it'll help bring some clarity to your life. It'll help bring some clarity to what God has called you to do. It'll help bring you some clarity to even your Sunday mornings, right? Because you clearly will know that you're called to be a minister of the Lord Jesus Christ wherever you go. And so I just want to encourage you to do that. You got to discover your purpose. And when you do that, time and money, that stressor, you're going to be able to say no to some things that really you said yes to in the past. It's because you didn't know why you were here on earth. I encourage you, discover that purpose. Understand why you live with a sense of purpose and urgency. Again, I promise you, here's the thing I know. Our time on earth is short, right? It's short. Look at what Psalm 39 says. Lord, remind me how brief my time is on earth, right? Like our time is short. Like I'm gonna live my life with this sense of purpose and urgency. Matthew, even Jesus said it in Matthew 13, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. And let me stop right there really quickly. There's something out there that if you will find a treasure, I believe it's in you. I believe that that's the purpose that you got to mine out on the inside of you, that you got to go digging for, that you got to discover it. And it's the reason why you were created. But right now, it might be a hidden treasure, but you got to find it. You got to discover it. And so when a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all that he had and immediately bought the field, right? I want to live my life doing that. What is the field that we should be giving our life to? Like, what's the urgency and the purpose that we should be living for? And it's the things that last forever, right? That's the things that we should be putting our... Trust me in this. You and I, when we get to the ends of our life, we are going to wish that we made a difference for eternity. Let's start now doing that, living with a sense of purpose and literally with a sense of urgency. Number two, second one that you got to do is this idea that you got to put first things first. All right, there's only a few things that I'm going to do and I'm going to make sure that I do them. I mean, there's a lot of options. There's lots of opportunity things out there and I don't mind doing all that stuff. But guess what? I'm going to put God first. I'm going to put Allie first. I'm going to put my family and my girls and my son first. I'm going to put you first, Purpose Church. I'm going to do that. And then if all that other stuff fits, well, praise God. I'll try and do some other stuff too. But I'm going to put the first things first. I love this prayer in Psalm chapter 90. It says, Lord, teach us to number our days, recognize how few they are, and help us to spend them as we should. Right, Jesus goes on to say it in Matthew 6. He said, but seek first. Somebody type the word first down below. Just type in the word first. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and then all of these things will be added to you as well. Right? Let's seek kingdom things first. Let's seek righteousness, and he'll take care of everything else. And now I'm not going to talk about money today a whole lot, but I do want to tell you, I'm going to even put God first in my finances. I want God to be first in my finances. God's getting my first. And I hope you don't hear me saying that as a church that we need anything, because we really don't need anything. We're debt-free by the grace of God. We have no debt. We got a lot of vision out in front of us, but we're debt-free. We don't have a need, but I just believe that when we put God first in our finances, the rest of it begins to take care of itself, because it's a heart thing, right? We're going to put first. I'm going to put God first in my time. When I wake up every morning, I'm going to put God first. I'm going to go scriptural before I go digital. Come on, somebody, right? I'm gonna read the word before I get into Facebook. I'm gonna read the word before I answer those emails. I'm gonna read the word before I text those people back. And trust me, when you put first things first, I promise your life is gonna be better. It's gonna take care of its other things. It's gonna take care of it if we will put first things first. And the last one I want to tell you about, and this principle to help you decide how to spend your time and your money, comes from Psalm 62. If we could really fix the time and the money thing, guess what? I think that there's going to be a lot of stress that we can begin to relieve, and then we can find some rest. How are we going to do that? I'm going to live with urgency. I'm going to live with purpose. I'm going to put first things first. And number three, I'm going to keep my heart set on heaven. Right? Here's what we want to do. I'm going to lower my expectation of earth, right? I think a lot of times we believe that we like heaven is going to be on earth, like everything should be perfect here, and it should be that's not going to happen. Not going to happen here. I think we got to lower our expectation. I think that's kind of the American gospel, is that, oh yeah, we can have everything that heaven has here on earth. Now look at me, church. By the grace of God, God has allowed us to live a very good life. But listen to me really quickly. Earth was never intended to be heaven. Right? It was never intended to be heaven. If you raise that expectation of earth, you're like, no, everything's supposed to work out perfectly. It's supposed to be just like this. I promise you, you will stay stressed, okay? You will stay stressed. I'm telling you, my great-grandparents and my grandparents, that generation, they really understood this well, right? I want to honor them because, man, you think about what they would sing about. You think about the songs that we sang growing up in church. I'll fly away. Come on, somebody, right? Come on. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning. Okay, right, don't ask me to sing again, right? Wasn't good. But I'll fly away, they were dreaming of a place called heaven. Their eyes were set on a place called heaven. I think about heaven came down, right? You remember that song? Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. It filled my soul. I sang again, I didn't mean to. But here's what I know. They're dreaming of heaven, right? They're thinking about heaven, and they were singing about heaven. That's why Paul encourages us in 2 Corinthians. Therefore, we do not lose heart, right? We don't lose heart. Though outwardly we're wasting away, though life becomes stressful, everything is crazy all around us, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. Why? For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Well, guess what, Paul? How do you do it? Guess how we do it? We fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. You know how I'm going to relieve some stress in my life? I'm going to fix my eyes on heaven. I'm going to fix my eyes on the fact that God is preparing a place for us. Even Jesus would talk with this about his disciples about this, because the disciples came to him and said, Jesus, you see all these problems that we got going on? And you could have probably understood that Jesus could have come to him and said, yo, yeah, let's pray about it. Let's, right now it's going to get better. Let's huddle up. Let's pray. Let's do all that. And Jesus probably could have done that, right? He could have done that. That was something that could have happened. And his disciples came to him. They were asking for a friend. Like, yo, how do we handle stress? Like, can we make this better right here, right now? And Jesus would respond, John 14, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. And well, look where he goes right after this. In my Father's house are many rooms. And if it were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going there to prepare a place for you. I just couldn't give you this stress message and leave you with the expectation that you can get your time and your money and everything in order and you'll never have stress again. No, trust me, you will. So sorry about that, right? I'm sorry. But you can have ultimate joy. Right? You can have ultimate joy because the Bible calls it a blessed hope, right? When you have your eyes fixed, not on the hope of this world, but on the hope that is heaven. And at the end of the day, and I want you to write this down, even type it in the comment section, Jesus offers more than a better now. He offers a better place. Right? He offers more than a better now. He offers a better place. And so the important decision that you have to make today is not necessarily about your time. It's not necessarily about your money, but are you ready for that place? Is your heart ready for that place? Do you know Jesus? And if you don't, today, that's the most important decision that you could ever make. So I want you to bow your heads, close your eyes wherever you're watching from, unless you're driving down the road, okay? Right? I want you to understand that God wants to speak to you right now. I believe He has been speaking to you, and this is the gospel, and that Jesus came for us, that we were sinners, that we messed up, that we were far from God, but while we were still sinning, that Christ came for us. And He gave up His life for you and for me, lived the life that we couldn't live, and the Bible just tells us that if we will put our faith and trust in Jesus, guess what? That He is faithful and just to forgive us. So wherever you are, you need to know Jesus. You need to get right with Jesus. You need to make that relationship with Jesus happen. Jesus already did all the work. It just comes to you and I making that decision to say, yes, God, it's my life for your life, Jesus. I exchange my heart for yours, God. And you can say something like this. You can pray something like this. Just say something like, "Dear Jesus, I want you to come into my life. I want you to save me. Help me live for you. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. And God, I put my trust that you were put in the grave, but that you got up out of the grave. So now, every day, I want to live for you from this day forward. God, thank you for saving me." And maybe you're out there, maybe you prayed that, maybe you prayed something like that. My heart and my hope is that, guess what? You just made the best decision that you've ever made in your life. There's not a better decision than what you just said. Not a better time management decision, not a better money management decision, other than a soul management decision that you just gave your soul. You just gave your life over to Jesus. And listen, as a church, we celebrate that. We love that because the prodigal son, the prodigal daughter has come home and there's more rejoicing. The Bible says there's more rejoicing. There's a lot of rejoicing in heaven, but there's more rejoicing over one person turning to Jesus in heaven. I love that. There's a party going on right here at Purpose Church. There's a party going on in heaven when one person comes to know Jesus. And so if that's you, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Just text the word PURPOSE to 270-229-6488. We want to do a good job of honoring that decision, walking alongside of you, coming and encouraging you in that decision. So if you could just text PURPOSE to that number, 270-229-6488, that would be incredible. Why don't we do this, church? Why don't, in the comment section below, why don't we give Jesus a big old ovation? Why don't we let our people that just made that decision know that we love them, that we're cheering them on? Yeah, I love that. Come on. I'm so excited about that. That is something that will never get old, people saying yes to Jesus. I love that. I love that. I love that. And so wherever you're at, I'll just tell you, thank you for believing in this vision that God has given Purpose Church. It is an honor to walk beside you and with you in this journey as we're trying to connect people to Jesus and help them live on purpose. And that happened today, I believe. I believe that's happened in the heart of some of you today, that you're starting to live on purpose with that sense of purpose. And so I just want to tell you, thank you for believing in that. And there's many of you that believe in that so much that we want to be generous towards that. That money idea that again, I'm a guy that believes in the wholehearted tithe of what the Bible tells us. Read Malachi chapter 3. And we believe that we want to give God the first fruits. We want to give Him a tenth of what we bring in, not because God needs our money. He doesn't need it, but He wants our heart. And He knew that if He can get our wallet, He could get our heart, right? Because that's what happens so many times. Man, I'm chasing after greed and all this other stuff. But God just says, hey, bring the first fruits to the storehouse. And so we just believe that the storehouse being the local church, the community of the church, where we have a chance to bring back to God what He's given to us, that we could never repay Him for salvation. We could never repay Him for the things that He's done for us. But man, we would love to just say, God, here's our 10%. Here's even above that, just to say, thank you for what you've done, Jesus. And so I just want to tell you, Purpose Church, if you do that, thank you so much. And I just encourage you, if you've never tried it, I would encourage you to start today. Just give it a shot. I'll give you the 3-month challenge. Do it for 3 months and see if literally your life in the next 3 months does not change. I just believe that for you. And just putting God first things first, right? That's what we're doing. And so thank you, thank you, thank you. Whether you give online, whether you give in person or mail it in, or whether you text to give, thank you for believing in what God has called Purpose Church to do. And that's going to be to connect a lot of people to Jesus and help them live on purpose from this day forward. I love that. Thank you for your generosity. It's literally our privilege, and it says it right there on that wall. We love to give. God, thank you for giving to us. We love to give back, right? And so thank you for doing that. And I'll just tell you, I hope you have a fantastic week. We got a great week coming next week too. Let me just tell you, you've asked the question, we're going to answer it for you. Are we living in the end times? Like, are these the last days that we're living in? We're going to talk about that next week. I can't wait for it. I hope to see you back. Let me pray for you, and I pray you have an incredible week. Jesus, I pray that you bless my friends, that you keep them, that you turn your face towards them, God, and that you shine your favor upon them. And at this week, in their time, in their money, in their stress, that God, they would be able to find rest in their soul, and that you would give them peace. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everybody said, amen, amen, amen. We love you. Have a great week.